Are you guys ready for pixie dust? I guess I am. I don't know. As it stands, we cannot hope to find the way to Urianje. For that, we must convince the pixies to lift the spell. From what I can make of the voices, the creatures want to play with us. If that is the case, they should permit us to find their village, Lita Laurent. Come, I have a sneaking suspicion this path will lead us directly into their midst. Oh, and I should mention that Minfilia has been informed of our situation, of the different worlds and our mission. You may consider her an ally. Well, here we are. Yet the pixies are nowhere to be seen. Knowing them, their games have already begun. In which case... Lara, there is a variety of plant native to these parts with a distinctive fur tip. Looking Glass, it is its name. So called because it can be used to spy pixies, believe it or not. I'll explain how I know all of this later, but first, I need you to help me find some. Oh, if a voice calls to you, under no circumstances should you respond. You will only subject yourself to further mischief. Face scrub. Do I get to scrub its face? You search the scrub but find nothing resembling Looking Glass. Suddenly, a voice rings out.
What is it that you seek, child? Perhaps I can help you find it. Huh, such a rude child, and too clever by half. I shall seek my fun elsewhere.
Searching the scrub, you find what appears to be Looking Glass, or grass. Ugh, why am I saying glass? Suddenly, a voice rings out.
Oh, a visitor! Where are you from, pray tell? Huh. Perhaps this one's hard of hearing. Ahem, what brings you here? Ah, stone deaf, how boring. Still, picking plants at our village is as good as indulging our hospitality. And who are we to turn you away? Stay while stay forever.
Your body begins to feel heavy.
Blech. Can't move. Help. Help me.
I take it you met with some trouble. Apologies for subjecting you to that. And I assume from your presence that you managed to find us some looking grass. Looking grass, possessed of a fur tip. This peculiar plant can apparently be used to see hidden pixies. Ah, I have seen the pixie grass. Yes, this is the stuff. Thus armed, we should be able to see through the pixies' veil of invisibility, and seeing them is the first step to dealing with them. Come, let's gather everyone and put Urianje's little trick to good use.
Farasitha, Krakleth.
No! We are found! How did this mortal know our trick?
Wait! I recognize their souls! These two have been here before!
Look! Twins! How adorable!
Aww!
Play with us!
We have neither the time nor inclination to play. We have come to see Urianje.
Oh yes, Urianje, the peculiar one! In return for a place in Elmeg, he agreed to a riddle contest with us for 7 days and 7 nights without any sleep.
Oh, that was so much fun! We must do it again!
I'm sure he'd be delighted. Now, if you'd be so kind as to lift your spell.
Shall we? Should we?
Would we?
What now?
I don't know, but this is their home, so we must indulge them.
Minds. We will lift our spell on one condition, that you first lend us a helping hand, or two, or three. Once you've helped solve all of our troubles, we'll let you see Urianji, Pixie's honor.
Well, there you have it. Pixie chores. I suggest we split up.
Look at me! Look at me! I have a task for you! Ul'dah is our beloved village, and we want it to always look lovely. And it can't look lovely without flowers blooming. And no flowers bloom lovelier than Everblooms. So here are some Everbloom seeds. Take them, sow them here, there, and everywhere around the village. Simple as a dimple, yes?
Everbloom seeds. These seeds will grow into an ever-chanting grass that, true to its name, produces ever-blooming flowers. Isn't that kind of the whole point of growing seeds? And planting seeds? But I don't seed anything.
Oh, I can't wait for the flowers to bloom! Perhaps I'll make pretty curtains out of them!
Do what you want.
Helping us grow flowers, are you? They'll make this house look so much lovelier. There used to be a city of mortals here. A great big bustling place called Volbert or Bovert or some such. But the Sin Eaters came and everyone disappeared. Since then, we Pixies have been living here and we've given the old houses our touch. Lovely, don't you think?
Well, they're not bad.
You're done sowing the seeds? Thank you! This shall help Lily Ron live up to its name, which means Flower House, in case you weren't aware. We weren't always here, you know. We used to live deep in a lush forest. It was beautiful beyond compare, but almost all of it was swallowed up by the light. For a while we roamed, but eventually we found a place that men had abandoned. Together, with our fellow fey folk, we decided to make it our new home. The land of everlasting spring! This is our home. And it could be yours too, forever and ever and ever.
As much as this place doesn't look too bad, I have to respectfully decline your offer.
Ease la la. I'm so hungry I may faint. Fruit, a little fruit will set me right. Will you go and fetch some for me? Just outside the village you'll find a hillock. Two great bell trees grow there. If you give them a shake, they should render up their sweet, succulent burdens.
Looks more like a tickle tickle than a shake shake. What am I going to take from this? Oh, hi. Bad crawler. Bad crawler. Are you going to poop out another crawler for me to destroy? So did the crawler give me that little bell tree fruit that I killed and it pooped it out? I don't know, this place is weird. Bellfruit, the sweet and succulent fruit of the bell tree, favored by pixies. Here's these.
Oh, thank you ever so much! You saved me! Yes, save me from my boredom! You should have seen the look on your face when the bugs came down, teehee! Ah, you've done me great service, mortal. If there's one thing we pixies are serious about, it's having fun! Dull and painful things? Hate, hate, hate them! Sin Eaters are dull and painful both, so we hate them especially. You mortals try to fight those monstrosities, but there's no fun in that. Best to avoid them altogether, we say.
Best to avoid them, but if I destroy them, you'll have to deal with them, which means fun all around.
Mortal, mortal, hear my plea. Our precious children are thirsty, and I need you to bring them water. Who are our children, you ask? Why, they're the leaf men you see standing about our village. Adorable, aren't they? Now, you'll need to go to Long Mirror Lake to draw the water. Once you have it, see that our children have a good drenching. Oh, but be warned, the Froth make their home in the lake. They tend to play rough, so have care.
You guys have eyeballs. Long Mirror Water. Pristine water drawn from Long Mirror Lake. Here's a bath. Sploosh. Bluey!
You've given water to our children? Thank you ever so much! They're all very dear to us. They wandered into El-Meg as stray mortals, but we grew attached to them and decided to take them in. You and yours would have been our children too, but the enchantment didn't catch as well as we'd hoped. It's never too late, of course.
How good is it, Dolara? So, a mix of menial tasks and pranks. Yes, that pretty much sums up my own experience. They have no troubles worthy of the name.
How long are we supposed to keep at this? They're clearly playing with us.
Indeed. Whenever I inquire how much more there is to be done, the answer is ever the same. A little. I doubt they have any intention of releasing us in the near future.
Ariange once told me a story about the Pixies. They're born from the souls of those who died as children, or so it's believed. Though they don't have memories of their previous lives, the desire to have fun remains, imprinted on their souls. And so they live only to play, keeping hapless mortals for their pleasure for years on end, sometimes even until death. In the past, when I sought to identify the true nature of ghosts, I came upon literature examining a similar subject. The soul is likened to a core that resides in the ether, and its presence is what differentiates us from such beings as sprites and arcane entities. Upon death, said core ordinarily dissipates alongside the ether that composed the flesh. However, it may be held together and bound to the corporeal realm, either by the will of its owner or by means of certain arts. In time, the soul may regather ether onto itself to assume another form, or find newly emerged life in which to abide. The Pixies may be one such instance of this. If ghosts are merely souls without bodies, what does that make us? I think you become that which you fear most, brother dearest.
However the Pixies may have come into being, if we leave them to judge when they are satisfied, they will never be satisfied. Nay, we must negotiate new terms with the creatures, but where to begin? It seems to me we would need at least one among them to sympathize with us.
In the course of your chores, did any of you encounter a pixie who seemed even faintly amenable to reason?
What? You knew a pixie from before?
Not only are you acquainted, but you've entered into a pact? You might have mentioned this sooner.
Nobody asked me.
At any rate, I dare to hope this will offer us a way out. Without further delay, then, summon this fell Ul, if you please.
A voice rings out in your mind.
So, my sapling has finally remembered about her lovely branch. But with such a half-hearted call, she may as well lop me off and cast me aside. I have no sapling. Please, Phil. Ooh, I need you. Is that your idea of a fervent call? A sodden log doeth more fire. Oh, loveliest of branches, please grant me your succor.
You're late! Late! I've been waiting for you to summon me ever since you came here. Waiting! But my sapling didn't so much as utter my name. Such a heartless thing she is. Cold and cruel and heartless!
Another self-important little brat. Just what we need.
Reminds me of my childhood.
All right, I'm sorry. It was a joke. Honestly, just a joke.
But just now you called for me so earnestly, so fervently. I couldn't possibly stay angry at you. Very well. As your lovely branch, I will lend you my strength.
For you to think of any new games, though, apparently. If I were you, I'd be bored of myself. Now let me make something clear. That mortal is mine. No matter what you do, she will never be yours. Never, never, ever!
Oh, not even a bit. But what about the others? Surely we can keep them.
No, you can't keep them either! They're for my amusement and mine alone! And if you lay so much as a finger on my sapling, I'll scatter the contents of her bag all over your precious village. There'll be cold, hard metal, furry, festering food, stinky, sweaty small clothes, and all manner of other terrible, unmentionable things. How would you like that,
All right. But will you not at least let us play with the twins? Just while the others go and see Urianje?
Aye, that's all we ask. And we promise we'll play nicely.
It seems we won't be joining you.
We'll reveal the hidden Fernick to you at once.
So this is the true Ilmeg.
How are you feeling?
Better. I think I remember the way now.
Apologies for the delay. Shall we go and see Urianje?
Your lovely branch is useful, yes? So whenever you're in trouble, you must remember to make use of me!
Ralph and Onalize is sick. Let us be quick. It would be a shame to return only to find that they had been made to play one game too many. Now, the place we seek is the abandoned manor of a nobleman and scholar. The Bookman's Shells, it's called, after the fellow's vast collection of tomes. An agreeable habitat for our friend. I'm sure you'll agree. Which direction? I'm getting dizzy. If we follow the path north, we should soon find the place. Come along. See you guys later. And here we are at long last. I give you Orange's humble abode. Come, let's see if he's home. I hope so. Knock, knock.
Orange, are you in?
Unto a world weary of heroes, a hero wends her way. The Exarch did send word that thou would seek me out, but ne'er did I imagine thou wouldst arrive so soon. Full glad am I to see thee once more, my friend, and none the worse for thy travails.
Run along, Minfilia. We will meet you outside.
But...
Another one for you to imbue, if you'd be so kind.
I take it thou hast met with our other comrades already? That Master Alfino and Mistress Alize now travel in thy company is of great comfort to me. As for the rest, it beginneth in earnest. The hunting of the Light Wardens, and perforce the war with Yulmore. Hark thee then to my words, and through them behold the vision that I did glimpse, that of the 8th Umbral Calamity. As I drifted hither to the first, traversing the boundary twixt reality and potentiality, I did bear witness to events yet to come. There I saw the combined forces of Eorzea and the Far East offering fierce resistance to the legions of Garlemald. So fierce, in fact, that they did begin to push the enemy back, ilm by painful ilm at first, then yalm by yalm, and malm by malm in time. Yet the joy they felt was short-lived, for in so doing they did force the Empire's hand. Faced with defeat, the Garleans turned to a weapon most vile. Black Rose. Its potency defied all reckoning. Once released, the gas took on a life of its own, wreaking untold carnage not only in Eorzea, but in the provinces of the Empire besides. From fighters upon the front lines to babes in their beds, none were spared. And as the casualties became too numerous to count, so did the fabric of civilization begin to unravel. Nor did the land itself escape unscathed, for spreading from the site of its release, Black Rose brought death to the very soil. To survive amidst the chaos and upheaval, men came to live by the sword, the rule of law giving way, inevitably, to the rule of might. Thus was the spark struck and the fire kindled, and swiftly did it spread as a blaze in a field of straw to engulf every corner of the world. Nations worthy of the name did then cease to exist, and those souls brave and true who might have risen to restore order. Were no more, for the weapon spared not one, not even thee. An endless age of war, begotten by the blight of Black Rose. Such is the legacy of the 8th Umbral Calamity which I did behold. No matter the cost, we must forestall this tragedy. To that end, I have labored during my sojourn in this world, discovering in so doing the answer to a pressing mystery. That of Black Rose's inexplicable potency. Come. Dost thou recognize yonder chart? Indeed. 'Tis a rendering of the elemental wheel, such as one might find in classrooms across the source. As the chart maketh plain, our world is composed of 6 elements, in addition to which there exist 2 poles in fundamental opposition. Astral, the active, umbral, the passive. As a reflection of the source, the first naturally compriseth the selfsame forces. Yet, curiously, there is a notable divergence in their nomenclature. To be specific, the denizens of this world employ not the terms astral and umbral. Thus was I moved to inquire what name said forces had been assigned. A simple question which yielded a most unexpected answer. Upon demanding the name of the pole aligned with activity and growth, I was told that as life's myriad colors combine to produce black, the people of the first had called it darkness. At this did my mind begin to race. Yet 'twas only when I asked what name had been given to the pole aligned with passivity that mine eyes were opened to the truth. Peace and tranquility being as purest white, unmarred by color, I was told it had been given the name of light.
That's umbral light and astral darkness, yes? I'm no etherologist, but it strikes me that the nomenclature of the first is rooted in the generation of the 2 forces, while our own appears to focus on their effects, which makes one wonder. Have we had it backwards all this time?
Tis indeed a compelling question, and one which beareth closer examination. Yet what knowledge we already possess sufficeth to explain the chain of events. The phenomenon of etheric thinning observed in the source is the consequence of light, the power of stasis, flowing in from the first to stifle the movement of ether within the land. And according to Master Alfino, Black Rose slayeth by halting the circulation of ether within living beings. Should such a weapon be unleashed, even as the first were rejoined, replete as it is with light,
we would have a disaster of untold proportions on our hands. A calamity. Well, at least we have a better grasp of what we're facing. Our objective, however, remains unchanged. We are to eliminate the Light Warden of Ilmeg. Speaking of which, were you able to ascertain its whereabouts?
Aye. Tis all but certainly ensconced within Leirgir, the castle which standeth in the midst of the lake. To enter said stronghold, we must needs turn to the Pixies for aid. Fortunately, I have become quite adept at courting their cooperation. Henceforth shall I accompany you, and do all in my power to ensure that my vision doth not come to pass.
My friend, ere I speak of the task at hand, there is a question I would pose to thee. What thinkest thou of mine appearance? Indeed, though the night be lost behind the shroud of blinding light, doubt not but that the stars shine still. I have chosen to avail myself of their guidance that I might navigate the sea of uncertainty that stretches before us. Or blessing, my prior studies of astrology did provide me with adequate grounding in the art. But enough of myself, let us now speak of our task. As I did mention, if we are to enter Lygia, we must needs gain the Pixies' cooperation. This is a simple matter, presenting unto them a suitable gift. I shall procure a selection of viands that shall please their palates. Thancred, pray assist me in this endeavor. Meanwhile, Dolara, I bid thee obtain that which will please their eyes. In these parts there abideth a Vowkin known for its beauteous wings, the Hawker. I shall lend thee a receptacle within which thou mayest capture a weakened specimen. We all like to think of the light as being like good and righteous. Sometimes what we consider to be the light and righteous is not always that great. Charlian box, an enchanted box designed in the traditional Charlian style. Thou art returned. Wert thou able to capture a hawker? Aside from me being here. Box hawker, even without the box's enchantment to hold in place, the creature has no more fight left in it. I beat it senseless. Ah, a truly magnificent set of wings. I shall treat them at once to make fast their vibrant colors. Thancred too should return anon, upon which I shall ready all the items of presentation. Pray take thine ease meanwhile.
Tis done. The Pixies shall be well pleased with these gifts. Ah, lest I forget. White aurasite, newly forged for thy use. Our mission being to thwart a rejoining, we will most assuredly cross paths with those who crave the contrary, our eternal enemies. Thus did I choose to abide in this ether-rich land, the better to fashion a trap for the Ascian's essence.
May I come in now?
You may indeed, assuming you've finished.
I did as you asked.
That's my girl, thank you. I should probably explain. Though my body remained behind in the source, its limitations saw fit to accompany me, which is to say, I cannot manipulate ether. I took up the gunblade for its defensive advantages, but on account of my little impairment, I cannot imbue the ammunition myself. Luckily for me, Minfilia has quite a talent for it.
Minfilia, once we set forth, we are not like to return for some while. If thou wouldst choose tomes to take with thee, let it be now.
Really? May I?
Of course, my dear. Yet have care thou dost not add overmuch to thy burden, lest I incur Thancred's ire. Hast thou spoken to her of thine encounter with the Minfilia of Eld?
Well, I suppose now is as good a time as any. As you know, I freed young Minfilia from captivity in Yulmore some 3 years past. Not long after, the two of us journeyed to the south of Armareng, to the edge of the Empty, where the Flood was halted. It was there that she awakened. The Minfilia of old. My Minfilia.
What must I do to bring you back?
My dearest Thancred, as I am now, I am no different from an Ascian. This child is but a vessel. One of many I have used that I might spread word of her enduring blessing and preserve the flame of hope. In my name, each has died, never having lived her own life. I have taken enough from these children. I will take no more.
But what of your suffering, your sacrifice? This isn't fair! I will not stand for it. I cannot. There must be something we can do. Tell me!
Should the day come when this child grows weary of fighting and wishes to cast it all aside, then shall I take up her burden. But should she wish instead to become the master of her own destiny, then shall I bequeath to her my all. Imbued with the strength that I reserve for rebirth, she may come to wield my powers as her own.
And what of my wishes? What of Flamine's? What of all the people who love and care for you and want nothing more than to see you again?
It is not their decision to make. It is hers. This child's. This Minfilia's.
Thank you.
you have ever watched over me, Thancred. Now I ask that you do the same for her. Protect her. Teach her. Stand by her as you stood by me. There is much and more she does not know. She needs a guide to show her the ways of the world, or she will never find her own path. When the time comes, you will find me here. Until that day.
Minfilia, wait!
What happened?
And then she was gone. Minfilia, the girl, claims to have no recollection of any of it. I have told her many things, where we came from, what we fight for, but of that day, I have not spoken.
With the coming of another possessed of the blessing of light, the first hath begun to rise up in defiance of its fate. The question remaineth, however, who shall take up the flame of hope which Minfilia hath borne for so long? Whether we will it or no, the choice must soon be made.
I'm sorry I took so long. It was so hard to choose. In the end, I settled on just the one.
That is well. Now, if all is in order, let us set forth for Leda Loran.
We weren't expecting you all back so soon. We had scarcely begun playing with the twins. That said, your gifts are truly wonderful. Let me tell you, the milk and honey and biscuits won't last a day, and the wings are the loveliest we've ever seen. You've done us a great kindness, and it's fate custom to return the gesture. If you desire anything of us, you need but name it.
So what is it that you desire? Rusty old coins like you mortals aren't one to collect, perhaps?
We are resolved to vanquish the Light Warden of this land. To that end, we desire entry to Light Gaia.
What a strange thing to wish for! You might as well ask us for your death.
But if that is what you want, who are we to argue?
Very well. I shall speak with the others.
Very well.
You've clearly been busy, Riange. Would you be so kind as to tell us what we've missed?
So that was the purpose of the gifts. Is there anything else you can tell us about this Light Warden? Aye, my lady. By circumstances most tragic, the Light Warden of this land is our king and ruler, Tatiana. It was not always so, of course. Our king fought the first Light Warden that threatened our home, you see. Fought it and won. But all the horrible light that came out when corrupted them, turning them into a new Light Warden. Now, their king only a name, not remains of the wise and just ruler that used to be. We had no choice but to seal them in the castle. The magic for breaking the seal, we divided into four, and wove each into a different relic to be kept apart until the name was right. Or time was right. And this dress is one of them. It's been in our safekeeping for years and years, but we've decided to entrust it to you.
Are you sure?
Of course. Custom demands it. Though you're most certainly going to your death, we thought we should at least let you try. That way we get to watch what happens. Of course, you can't break the seal unless you have the other relics too. The shell crown is with the Gfroth, the stone scepter is with the Numo, and the crystal shoes are with the Amaro. Good luck finding them all.
The facts thus disclosed confirm my own understanding. Our quest lieth now before us.
First, let us hide to the lake, there to claim the shell crown from the Fuoth. If we call to them before the untouchable gate, they will answer.
Hearken to me, O spirits of the water. We are come with an entreaty.
Not in a talkative mood, apparently. I'm not exactly sure how the gate works. But with the froth or water spirits, perhaps we should take our search into the lake. I suppose a brief dip wouldn't hurt. We all know Thancred swims like an eel, but what about you, Minfilia? I can swim well enough. Thancred taught well. Oh, taught me. Oh, man. Excellent. I'm butchering everything. What about you, Oriange? I'm not sure I've ever asked. Rather than swim, mayhap it would be more expeditious to walk upon the surface by means of magic. You too, Oriange? That you should be a kindred spirit. Oh man. Spirit. Worry not, my friend. I know some helpful tricks, and I should be more than happy to share them with you. Together we shall conquer the waves. Well, well, aren't we a lovely lot? And you have an entreaty for us, you say? An entreaty from mortals? What a treat.
Aye, my comrades and I are on a quest to vanquish the Light Warden. To that end, we would humbly beg the loan of the Shell Crown, which we are given to understand is in the safekeeping of your people.
Oh? Is that all? Of course, you may have it. You shall have it.
Just like that. What do you want from us?
Oh, no need to be suspicious. The crown simply doesn't mean much to us, is all. As a matter of fact, nothing means much to us. We froth, it's over before it's begun, and we couldn't care less what becomes of the Fairy King, nor the world for that matter. Having said that, we do so seldom have mortal visitors, and it would seem a shame not to make the most of you. Touch the untouchable gate and come hither to our domain. Don Meg, in your tongue, it means forbidden realm. Sounds forbidden, yes? And so it should, for we are one with the water, our home wrought of ripples and waves and currents. Find your way through, give us thrilling sport, and we will give you the crown.
Have it no other way. Seldom have I enjoyed such sport.
we have satisfied thy demands, wilt thou now satisfy ours?
Of course! Of course! There it is, the relic you seek. Yours for the taking. Have care you do not break it, though, yes. Ah, but you, my friend, you are mighty indeed, and pleasing to the eye, besides.
Watch her forever!
Why don't we just make her one of us? Yes! One of us!
One of us! One of us! One of us! One of us! One of us! One of us!
One of us! One of us! One of us!
What a fine idea! Why ever didn't I think of that? You may have the crown, but in exchange, we will have you!
Wake up! Wake up, damn you! Thank the gods. I don't know where you learned to breathe underwater, but it's lucky you can. I'm sure you had your reasons, but the first rule of dealing with the Fwarth is do not deal with the Fwarth. It's said that they are born from the souls of the drowned. Were it not for your little trick, you'd have joined them. Your friends are safely back on dry land, in case you were wondering. They'll be searching for you, I expect. That's the royal capital of the kingdom of Verber, Dana. It's seen better days. They were a stubborn lot, the Verbertites. Set in their ways. But once you got to know them, you couldn't find a more welcoming people. It always froze over in winter, being up in the mountains. So we'd pull up our chairs round the fire and trade tales over steaming bowls of lamb stew, while the street lamps burned hot and bright outside. All dead and buried now. Them and anyone else who might remember. Everything we did. Everything we gave. What was it for? I wonder. I hope you'll have a better answer than this when all's said and done.
I'm going back in. Nay, my lady, exhausted as thou art, thou wouldst only endanger thyself. I prithee, rest a moment. There is nothing where we looked. Delara! Dear gods, were not for Sorbonne's blessing, but I need not labor the point. I'm glad to see you safe and well, my friend. Have you any idea how worried we were to wash up on the shore only to find you weren't with us? Oh, but I'm forgetting. Here's your crown, your majesty. The Froth kept that part of the bargain, at least. While there were certain twists and turns, our work here is done, with everyone none the worse for wetness.
Oh, thank goodness you're still here.
So, Ulun, is something amiss?
A great big mob of mortals is marching to Omeg. Mortals with ugly weapons and uglier faces.
They wouldn't happen to be your friends, would they? Rather the reverse, I fear. The Amorian army, I'd guess.
Meaning, we can play with them?
As much as you like, but just to be sure, I will return with you to confirm their identities. If they are who we suspect, we will require your aid.
If Alphino is coming, then Alize will be too, yes? Can't have one without the other, you know?
Alright, just remember, we're not your playmates this time.
I'm afraid we must leave the rest of the relic hunt in your hands.
Indeed you have. Very well then. See you afterwards, my friend. And with that, we draw a close. Join me next time and we'll figure out what's going on. Until then, take care.